Hey everybody, it's Pastor Dylan and welcome to the Dayspring Wesleyan Church Podcast. At the end of this episode, please take the time to download our church app. It's the best way to stay connected to the life of the church. All you have to do is go to the App Store, search for Church Center, download and enter the information for our church. You will then be connected to our church community. I hope the following presentation inspires you to move closer to God in this journey we call faith. Enjoy.
Good morning, church. Well, they only gave me one announcement to share with you this morning. So here's the announcement. If you have all... All right, I don't know what that was. Do I need to switch mics? Okay. What's happening is all those of you who signed up for helping with the thanks and giving meal that we're doing this Thursday, we want to make sure that you know we've sent out an email to you with the times and information and where you need to be and when. So please try to get there and read that email, and that would make us just so happy. And we'll be able to take care of so many things. I want to say this morning, too, I officiated the coldest wedding outside I've ever done. And so while most of you were warm yesterday, I was outside doing the vows and all that stuff with a couple, and we had a great time. And it was the first time that the audience was shaking more than the groom, you know. So we had a good day with that. I also know that I've been listening to a song like every day for the last week, like over and over, and any of my kids who would drive with me are probably sick of hearing it. But the song has just been a reminder of, I think, how we should live or how we should feel. The song is I'm So Blessed by Kane, and I don't know if any of you heard it, but it's kind of a catchy song, fun, uplifting song. But the first line of the song that I've really connected with, it says this: trouble knocking at my door today, I'm not going to let it in. Worry going to steal my joy away, but I ain't going to let it win. It then goes on to say, on my best day, I'm a child of God. On my worst day, I'm a child of God. Oh, every day is a good day, and you're the reason why. And I have to tell you, it's just so uplifting because I think that we face so many pressures and situations in life where we need to be reminded how God is in the midst of all of that and how that I am so blessed to have him in my life. And I have to tell you, I feel so blessed with the way things are happening in the church. We've been growing numerically for a while now, but it's just not the numerical growth to me. It's about the spiritual growth that we've seen take place. Within the last month, we've had 12 people accept Christ for the first time into their lives. That's something to praise God about, yeah. We've also seen the growth in all of you reaching out to the community. We've seen a growth in our volunteers at the church. And I even understand that through sort of the hard times we're going through, a lot of us financially have not been able to give like we once did. But I have to tell you that God has been raising up other people within our congregation that have been giving as well. And we've been seeing our giving either stay normal or go up a little bit. And it's been allowing us to continue to do ministries here of the church. I'd say we have a great staff here. I mean, just exceptional. The amount of time and energy and work that they put into so many things that you don't see. There are a lot of things taking place behind the scenes. But I love how they're cooperating together. They're doing life together. I have to tell you that life has been so good for me here at the church. And though life has been good for me at the church, I have to tell you personally, it's been a little bit more of a challenge or a little bit more of a struggle. As most of you know, I lost my mom like a month ago, I think, by now. And we're doing a lot of first. You know, we're going to be doing the first Thanksgiving, first Christmas, first New Year's without mom. We're finding the challenges of not being able to call mom when we want to. Dad's having to make some adjustments on that, and you know, you're always concerned about other family members as well, but those are a lot of challenges. There are the challenges, and I don't want to get into specifics about this, but just know that I can use your prayer. There's some challenges that you have with kids at times as well, and there's some things that we're going through that, you know, we just need prayer for. And then there's those challenges just for me personally, physically. And I think about a year ago, I found out that I had high blood pressure, so they put me on a pill, and that pill was working for some time. But then about 6 months ago, I realized that I felt very dehydrated, and my legs were constantly cramping up. Matter of fact, between services, my foot would cramp up in a weird way. I thought, oh no, I hope it doesn't do that up front. And so being a procrastinator, I finally went to the doctor, and we were looking into things, and you know, it's interesting going to the doctor, by the way. I think Brian Regan put it this way. It's the only place that you pay a lot of money for someone to insult you, you know, and I agree with that, you know. So some time ago, a year ago, when I had the high blood pressure, he said, you need to lose some weight, you know, and I was like, yeah, that's true. So when I went this time, the good report was, he said, well, you've lost 35 pounds. And I said, yes, I have, you know, so that's a good thing. But he did my blood work, and he said, because I really couldn't stay hydrated. I was drinking like 2 gallons of water a day. I was drinking like a carton of orange juice and Gatorade and just all the stuff. Could not stay hydrated. And so I said, I don't know what's going on, but we got to fix something. And so they did some blood work on me, and what they found out is that I have type 2 diabetes. And they said that that it's actually curable or reversible. And stuff, and he says, if you follow this plan for like 3 to 6 months, we think we can take care of that. He also told me my sodium was very low, and he says that's what's causing the cramping. So the blood pressure medicine they put me on had kind of a water pill on it as well, and so they took that part off of it. And so I went on, he said, here's the plan, all right? He said, we need you to lose about 20 pounds. He says, I need you to take this one pill every day. And then he said, you know, you need to exercise and do low carbs. So there was this plan put in place that was supposed to provide me better health. So so I thought, well, let's do it. Let's stick to this, you know, let's do this plan. Let's stick to it and everything. And so after the first week of dieting, I gained 6 pounds. So that was fun. But I found out that was because... since they took away the water pill, all the water was retained again. So I was like, okay. And so then I lost another 4 pounds this last week. So I was like, okay, so we're gonna commit to this. We're going to stick to it. The other thing is the one pill that I've taken, and you're going to see me wearing my glasses a lot longer for right now, but there's some sort of side effect that I have lost some good vision and stuff. So when I take these off, you guys are all very blurry, you know, and a lot of you look a lot better because of it. So I'll just let you know. So I have to wear my glasses now, and these are just reading glasses, even to see you from some distance. And then you will not see me reading from this Bible today because I cannot see those words to save my life. So I had to blow them really big up on this paper up here. So if you notice that, I've got to figure out some changes with that as well. And I think they'll put me on some other medicine. Hopefully that vision will come. So those are things you can pray for me about as well. But there is a plan that has been put in place by the doctor for me really to get some health in my life. And, you know, this plan requires following it, making sure that I know everything that they said. You know, and I started thinking about, we have a plan for the church as well. And I don't know how many of you know what our mission here is, the church, but I'm going to have you repeat this with me in a minute so you know it. But we decided not to do a mission statement because mission statements for a lot of people are very hard to learn or to memorize. But what we've done is we come up with 4 missional verbs. And these are the verbs, and you're going to repeat them with me in a moment. But they are reach, grow, worship, and serve. All right, so I want you to say those with me. Ready? Reach, grow, worship, and serve. The idea is this, that we want to reach the lost. We want to grow in our faith. And we want to worship our Creator. And then we want to serve our community. And that's really what it comes down to. And that's the plan and that's the mission that we've done. We're going to continually do all 4 of these verbs every year. But my emphasis for the church and what I've told the staff is and the board, I want to just focus on 1 word every year and say, this is going to be the emphasis that we're going to do. And so what we chose to do this year is to work on the word grow. And I want you to know, remember, it's growing in faith. It's not necessarily about growing numerically, which we've done, but it's about people growing in their faith. And we knew that for people to grow in their faith, there needed to be some discipleship done. So I have to tell you, in the last year, what we've seen is we've seen our women's ministries, we've seen them grow. We've seen some of our small groups grow. We've seen a men's ministry started this year, and we saw great numbers at the first event. And I want to, again, publicize what they got going on Saturday, because it's another way for men to get involved. And I have to tell you, men, we need you to grow specifically. And the reason why is because we have too many young boys growing up not seeing men in the church and not seeing them step up. It's very easy for us to do women's ministries, but it's a little bit more difficult to do guys' things. And we need those little boys to understand that it is important that even at a young age and even when we get older, for Christ to be at the center of what we do. We made sure that this year, like we plan to do a small group thing on Sunday nights. And it has been overwhelmingly exciting. When we started this thing, my hope and my prayer was that we would get 100 people at this small groups on Sunday night. And the first night we had 200 people at small groups studying the Word of God. And I have to tell you, that just blew open my faith. Now, those numbers haven't stayed at 200, but they've been well above 100. They've been 150. And I have to tell you, church, that excites me because we have 150 people getting into the Word of God, hopefully daily and every week. And that's something to be excited and to be proud about. But that was the plan and that was the purpose this year. You see, I want you to know that I believe that the Word of God is one of the most important things that we have in our lives. I believe that the Word of God is God's revelation to humanity. It's telling us who God is, how He functions. It's a guideline for our life. It's an historical account of what God has been doing, of what He will continue to do. And it's more than just a historical account. It is His story, God's story, and His love for humanity that He is sharing with every one of us. I want you to know, first of all, that this church believes that the Bible is the inerrant Word of God. That means we believe it is without fault. Now, there may be times a pastor or a speaker may misinterpret something, but the Word of God is perfect. And if it's not, then it becomes to some pastor or some speaker begin to choosing what he believes to be right and wrong. And church, I'm not willing to do that. There is no politician that can decide what is right and wrong. There is no pastor that can decide what is right or wrong. There is no parent that can decide what is right or wrong. The only thing that we can go to is the Word of God to know what is right and what is wrong. And we have to believe in that wholeheartedly. You see, we believe this. Thank you. We believe the Word of God does the work of God as the Spirit of God works on the hearts of the people of God. The Spirit intersecting with what we are reading allows us to begin to apply it to our life. Now, here's the problem, church. And I'm going to be reading my notes a little bit more on this one. But the Bible was once the focal point of our American culture. But if you look at it today, that is no longer the case, is it? The Bible is more of a decoration or an heirloom that we pass down in our homes today. Did you know that 9 out of every 10 households in America has a Bible, but few actually read it? Someone once said that if everyone in America read their Bibles at the same time, we would experience the worst dust storm in history. According to a Gallup poll that was done about 3 years ago, 1/3 of Americans don't know who preached the Sermon on the Mount. Matter of fact, a large number said it was Billy Graham. And Billy Graham has passed away, and he was definitely old when he passed away, but he is not as old as the Sermon on the Mount. That's in the Bible. Fewer than half of the people that were polled could name the first book of the Bible. Gallup says that Americans revere the Bible, but we have become a nation of biblical illiterates. Another study conducted said that the most widely known Bible verse is God helps those who help themselves, which isn't even in the Bible. Ben Franklin actually said those words, and it's not in Scripture. 82% believe that it is in the Scriptures, and 81% of born-again Christians believe that it is in the Bible. Worse yet is this. In my own home, I asked my two youngest children, I asked them a question one day because I just wanted to see what their knowledge of the Bible was. And I said, Colette and Isaac, I said, and this was at different times, by the way, wasn't at the same time. But I asked them individually, I said, who was put in a basket and put down the Nile River? And my kids, both of them at different times, said Jesus. And although Jesus is an answer to a lot of things in our life, that was not the correct answer that day. I started asking my kids why they thought that, and it wasn't like totally off in some of their thinking, but they said, Dad, it was because all those babies were killed around that time, so it needed to be put in the basket. And I said, yeah, they kind of mixing the two stories together a little bit. But I thought, even in my own household, my kids don't know certain things of the Bible. And I have to tell you, church, that I was challenged by that. You see, church, our culture is sick, and our church is sick, and we need to get well. We need to get well individually, and we need to get well corporately as well. Church, here's what I want you to know. I'm committed to these things. I'm committed to make the Word of God known, to make the gospel the good news of Jesus' saving work, to make it practical, and to make sure that our children and our teens leave here knowing the Word of God, knowing that they are loved, and knowing that they are valued. Just like a doctor gave me a plan for my health, I think we too need a plan for spiritual health as well. I think we need a church that individually, the people here, need to be committed to the Word of God. We need to open up our Bibles and we need to read it. We need to make sure that we're passing down to the next generation the truths of the Bible. We need to make sure that as our church is growing, that our kids' programs and our teen programs make sure that kids are leaving here knowing the Word of God, knowing and how to answer the little things. And I have to tell you, we are doing a serious look right now at saying, what can we do better? But I believe that you as individuals need to do the same things in your own households. I've been committed right now, and my plan of action is to make sure that I'm quizzing my kids every day with just some of the simple truths of the Bible, because I want them to know what the Word of God says. But I believe corporately we need to do a work as well. The early church had a plan. And so today we're going to be reading from Acts chapter 2. We're going to be looking at verses 42 through 47. Because I believe that there's a plan that is put in place, a plan that will help us get well individually, and I think it's a plan that will help us get well corporately as well. So let's read together. Verse 42 through 47. It says this, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship and to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe as the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and they ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all people. And listen to this, and the Lord added daily those who were being saved. Let's pray together, church. Father God, I pray that in this moment, as we would look at your word, and as we would study and as we would talk about it, that there would be a moving of your spirit within our own lives that would push us to say, you know what? I want to know Jesus in a better way. I want to know God in a better way. I want to sense the Holy Spirit in a better way, in a way that moves me to be a better person, in a way that assures me of the kingdom of heaven, in a way that makes me and causes me to make a difference in our world today. Father, I pray that if there's anything that I would say that is incorrect today, that you would clean it up in the ears of your people so that the only word that they hear today is yours. In your name we pray. Amen. Excuse me. So here's the history. It's basically the day of Pentecost that is happening sometime before all these things are taking place. The Holy Spirit has now come upon the church. He has filled them in a unique way. Peter is now in the temple courtyard, and he is basically preaching the gospel. He is an eyewitness to what has transpired, to what is taking place. And as a result of his preaching, listen to this, 3,000 people responded to the message. All right? Not three people, not 300 people, 3,000 people responded to the presentation that day. I have to tell you, church, I'm just happy if one person responds, you know? And 3,000 people that day responded to the gospel. That means that they now had 3,000 new converts to the faith who gave their lives to Jesus Christ. These new believers lived in a very hostile environment. If you remember, about 6 weeks earlier, the Messiah leader, Jesus Christ, who had been with them and had been teaching them, had been put on a cross and he had died. That's the environment that they were living in. And then Jesus is raised, and the disciples witness that resurrection of Jesus. But there's other people in the community that don't even believe that he rose from the dead. They believe it's just a myth, or they believe it's just some lie that they're perpetuating out there in this world today. And what is interesting is, underneath this environment, underneath this situation, they knew that meeting together would eventually maybe cost some of them their lives, and they knew that they would be persecuted because they would be persecuted by the Romans, and they would be persecuted by other Jewish people because of this fact that they believed in Jesus Christ and they were now converted. So now what do they do? How do they respond? What's their plan like moving forward? And I have to tell you, church, I think that we're living in a period of persecution today. And I don't think that we're living in the physical persecution necessarily in America that other countries may experience. But I think we're living in a persecution that is mentally struggling for us. I believe that what's happening in our world today is people are telling us that Christians are not as intelligent, that they don't know what they're talking about. I was talking to a science teacher at one of the local schools. And the teacher told me that they went to a conference. And in this conference, they had a speaker who was speaking about all the science and was speaking about how they believe that creation took place. And in the midst of all this, they were telling the different theories. And one of the people in the audience raised their hand and said, "I have a question." They said, "What do we do with these crazy people that believe that God created the earth in 6 days?" The speaker stopped for a moment as everybody else was listening in. And the speaker said this. The speaker said, "You know, I was brought up in the home of a pastor. And I have to tell you, there are so many people like my dad who just don't have a clue when it comes to science." And they said, "You can't prove to me that God created the earth in 6 days. Let me give you the other stuff." You see, that's the world that we're living in, where people no longer believe that God could have created us. We have been named bigots and liars. This speaker said that Christians are perpetuating a myth or a lie, including his dad. You see, church, this is the world that we're living in today. There is probably a part of us that wants to retaliate against a lot of this stuff and to raise our fist and to say, "This is what we believe." But church, I think in our world, we better learn how to love in the right way so that people see that there is a difference in knowing Christ. We need to love unconditionally. I want to make this more personal for some of you because I believe that there's not just an attack on the church, but I believe that there is an attack in our homes as well. I believe that there is an attack on our children. I actually, and I don't care where you stand on the whole COVID thing, but the COVID thing has messed up some of our kids. That experience of just isolating them for that time period has done something to those kids, and they've lost a year or two of their lives because of it. And they don't know some of them no longer know how to get out and be a part of society. And there is an attack on the homes. Some of you, COVID actually attacked your marriages in a very unfortunate way because some of us weren't used to being home together so much and having to deal with one another so much, right? And so we had to learn again how to deal with it, or some of us just sort of ignored the situation. We pulled away from each other. There's been an attack on that. Some of us, there's been an attack not only in our homes, not only in our families and marriages, but there's been an attack at work as well. And so we just don't feel like we're as valued as much as we once did. And I believe, church, that in order for us to get healthy in all of these, I think all of us need to have a plan or a process in which we say, this is the way that we're going to function. This is the way that we're going to move forward. So if you look at these passages today, I want to sort of align, I think, how the early church sort of came together and said, this is how we're going to deal with this. So first of all, I want you to know this. I believe that they committed to the plan. And I think all of us need to come up with a plan, and I think we need to commit to that plan, whatever it may be. It says in verse 42, they've devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship and to the breaking of bread and to prayer. You see, they met together, they began to open up the scriptures, and it wouldn't have been the Bible as we see it, but they were talking about all these things that the apostles were saying, and they were relating it to what they knew about the Old Testament, and they were figuring it out together, but it was happening because in community they were talking with one another, they were suggesting things, they were debating things, they were talking about it, and it wasn't a debate like you and I see it as we're just going to fight this thing out. It was more like we want to come to some sort of common ground. We want to agree on something so that the end of the day we can say this is how we need to move forward. And so they did those things together, and it wasn't just about reading stuff together, but it was about living life together. It was about, they said, fellowshipping with one another. And there's something that happens in fellowship as you're discussing the Word of God, because when you and I begin to fellowship, we begin to talk about what's going on in our own lives. We begin to sort of illustrate to one another, like, sort of, these are the things that I'm struggling with. These are the challenges that I have. Here's some of the joys that I'm experiencing. And we get to talk about those things together. And there should be something sort of exciting and something moving about that. It should challenge us in a way that says, here's the plan that we have. Here's what we're going to be committed to, and we're going to keep following it. It actually says that they broke bread together. And there was a study done a long time ago, by the way, and what they found is they found that women can get into a room and not even know each other, and they can just start talking with one another about anything. And then they said they did the same thing to guys, put them in a room, and they say nothing. But then they said you put donuts and coffee in front of a bunch of guys, and they start to talk. And I don't know what it is about that, but there's something about being at a table, eating together. Maybe it just starts out, boy, this is a good donut. Yeah, this is great coffee. Hey, how about that game? And then we can talk with one another to where guys are crying at the table together. Not really. I mean, that doesn't really happen, okay? But there's something that begins to let our guard down, and we begin to talk with one another. So there's something important about breaking bread together that says, letting my guard down, let's talk and let's discuss and let's get into it. And so what they were doing is they were developing a plan. And I have to tell you, church, listen to this. I don't know what the plan is for your life, but there needs to be a plan. I don't know what your plan is to grow closer with the Lord, but you need a plan and you need to commit to it. You need to come up with something that says, here's the amount of time I'm going to spend with God and His Word. Here's the amount of time I'm going to pray. Here's what's going to take place in my life. Here's the time I'm going to set apart. And then listen to this. That's obeying the first commandment, which is loving the Lord our God with our heart, soul, mind, and strength. It's about putting Him first, saying that I am going to make my day around God instead of everything else, and then just hoping that I can find some sliver of a little bit of time for God. You see, we work our lives around everything else, and I've been very convicted about this. Because it seems like our life is worked around all of our kids' activities. And then here's a little place for God. And church, God should be the first thing. I love my kids, and I think some of them are talented. And oh, how I would love for them to be in professional sports and to buy me a house. That'd be great. But that's probably not going to happen. But one thing I know will happen is that God can be in their life. And He can be a focal point for them. And even though I can't guarantee them all the riches of this earth, if they follow Christ, I can guarantee them the riches of heaven. And that, to me, is the most powerful legacy I can leave them. And so there's something about that that says we need to be committed to a plan. And for some of you, listen to this. For some of you, you're just struggling in other areas with other attacks that are going on. I would tell you this. Whatever that area is, whether at work, whether it be in your marriage, or whether it be with your kids, start thinking right now. Start having those conversations. Start bringing other people into the mix. Start reading things online that people that know what they're talking about, and start committing and developing a plan that you're going to follow. Secondly, in verse 43, we realize the need to celebrate moments. It says, everyone was filled with awe as many wonders and signs were performed by the apostles. I was having this discussion with my brother-in-law, who's, by the way, is Pastor Bo. And I'm so thankful because I didn't think anyone would ever marry my sister. So I just want to say thank you to him. She's not here today to hear this, so be gentle. Oh, she is. Oh, sorry. I was talking about my other sister that I don't have. Anyways, she's way in the back, so she will probably pound me later for that. But anyways, Bo and I were talking, and they've had the opportunity to have a couple foster kids within the last couple years. And it has been a major struggle for them in trying to relate to these kids that have, you know, just sort of a lot of messed up situations, and how do you deal with it? And there's a lot of baggage and stuff that they bring to the table. There's a lot of work that you have to invest in. And even, you know, even in their own kids. And one of the things Pastor Bo said to me, he says, you know, I found, and this was helpful to me and something that we're dealing with, he says, you have to celebrate moments. He says, because you can put a plan together and that plan goes awry. But then every once in a while, something will happen and you need to celebrate that moment. And I have to tell you, I would love to tell you that every time I open up the Word of God, every time that I pray, like everything just goes well, the music starts playing, the harps start going, you know, and God just miraculously does all this work. But man, that doesn't happen. There are days when I just cry through almost the day and say, Lord, I need you really to intervene. I need you to step in. I need you to do this. And it feels like nothing happens. But then there are those moments when a song comes on the radio, or there's a verse that I read, or somebody says something that reminds me of how valued I am in God, and I have to celebrate those moments. There are times, I bet, in your marriages where you think everything is going wrong and this is a waste of time. Listen, celebrate those moments when love is shown. Celebrate those moments when you connect with one another. Maybe there are times that you feel like you've invested in your kids and you're getting nothing out of it and they're not making any sense and you just feel like, you know, I'm the worst parent in the world and I'm there, you know, why would God ever let me have children because I don't even know how to raise them? Listen, there are going to be those moments when your kids do something right or when your kids learn something or they say something and you're just like, and all. Listen, celebrate those moments. There will be times at work when you're trying to figure out, you know, should I still be in this job? Am I still called to what we're doing? Listen, when something good happens, celebrate those moments and continue to work on the plan. You see, church, we have to have these moments, even in the faith, where you say, you know what? I know that my relationship with God is more important than anything else. I know that I may have troubles. I know that there are trials. We kind of know all the right answers. But when something good happens, celebrate those moments. If you need to write them down, write them down so that one day when you're feeling down and depressed, you can go back and look at those things. I have to tell you, God speaks to me through a lot of music. And there are music some days that I'll just listen. Like I said, I'm listening to that song over and over and over again that just reminds me that I am blessed. And it keeps me going. Thirdly is this. I want you to agree with the process that you've committed to. You see, it says all the believers were together and they had everything in common. What was that thing that was in common to them? It was this belief that Jesus died on the cross and he was risen from the dead. And they were committed and they agreed with that one thing. And because they agreed with that one thing, they said, here's the plan that we're going to move forward with. Here's what we're going to do. We're going to keep doing this. We're going to keep coming together. We're going to have unity within the body of believers. And church, listen, I've given you the mission verbs. That's what we're committed to. And as a body of believers, we kind of need to agree on that. Like, we need to agree that these things are important, that this is what's going to set DaySpring apart from other institutions that are out there. This is what's going to set the church apart. We're going to agree on these things because we believe that Jesus Christ is the head of the church. And we believe that as a church, we should reach, that we should grow, that we should worship, and that we should serve. Like, that's the common ground that we have. And I have to tell you, we've been in a world that is so disunified. And one of the things that Jesus prayed when he was in the garden, we talked about the Garden of Gethsemane a couple weeks ago, but one of the things that he prayed in some of the other books is this. He prayed that there would be unity within the believers because he believed that unity would show the world who Jesus was. And there needs to be unity in that. And I have to tell you, for some of you that are parents and you're trying to raise kids, there are times that we disagree on how we should raise our children. There's times that we disagree on what the punishment should be, right? And those become arguments, those become problems and contentious for us. And here's the problem, and I think the kids kind of experience this, but you and I need to agree. We need to come together for the purpose of our children. Because if not, they'll play us off one another, right? I mean, how many of you have told your kids no, and then they go right to the other parent and ask them? You know, you almost need to text your other, you know, spouse right away and say, hey, I just told them no. Don't say yes, you know? Because then they just use that against us. But we need to come together in that. We need to come together in our workplaces. We need to agree that this is sort of the mission and vision of where we're going. You need to agree that the Bible is still important and that you need to read it. And you believe that in reading it, it will cause you to be healthy in your relationship with God. So agree to the process. Fourth, I believe there's a level of buying in to your plan. It says this, they sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. And I have to tell you, church, there's always these debates on, you know, how much should we give to people and all this stuff. And I would love to spend time with you on how the Old Testament dealt with people who were poor and had difficult situations. But this, what this was about for this specific time was this. They sold their possessions because they believed that for the people of God to continue to move forward, because they knew they were going to experience persecution. They knew that they were going to experience some hard times. They thought, if anyone is having trouble, then we will allow that money to help the others out. It's one of the reasons why we take up tithes and offerings, and we don't talk about it a lot. But, you know, we always talk, There's a level of giving that says if we can give 10%, that's what we need to do. And I know for some of you that'd be very difficult because it's not into your budget. And so for some of you, I'd say if you ever work on your giving, just try to give like 2% maybe the first year. Try to up it the next year until it becomes very comfortable. I have to tell you, giving for me is very easy. And the reason why is because my mom and dad, whenever we made money, we had to give 10% to the church. And so I have to tell you about putting God first. So when I put my budget together, the first thing I always put is tithe. When I talk to couples, one of the things I say is, here, I don't know if you're going to do this, but you should put tithe first. And then I live off of everything else. And so I don't live outside my means. That's what I try to do. Now, I'd love to tell you that it's always easy, but we're living in an economy right now that is stretching my butt. I mean, we're trying to feed 5 kids, you know, and the good thing is I have to be on a diet, so I will eat less so they can eat more, you know. So that's a good thing. So we're hoping that kind of evens out. But there needs to be, honestly, a level of buy-in that you do to where you say, you know, I'm so committed to this that I'm willing, and I always talk about this too, that it's, I think we need to give our time and our talents as well. Because I've always found if we give our time and our talents, we need less treasure to do what we need to do. And I believe the same thing's true in your home. I believe the same thing's true in your marriages. I don't think it's always about necessarily like monetarily buying somebody something, but I think sometimes the buy-in is time. Spending with your family, time at work, those are all investments. I believe it's about using your talents. Like there are certain things that my wife does really well, there are certain things that I do really well. And I think that you need to step into that because that's the buy-in. And so when you come up with a plan, it should be, okay, this is what I'm good at, this is what they're good at. You remember when it talks about the body of the church? Not everyone can be a hand, not everyone can be a foot. But it takes the body of believers coming together to do a greater work. And when you and I buy into that, when you and I buy into the fact that I need to read the Word of God every day, that I need to spend time in that, I mean, that's a level of commitment that's taking it to another step. And that's an area where growth happens. And so lastly is this. Fifth, and verse 46 is this, stay the course. And says this, every day they committed to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and they ate together with glad and sincere hearts. And I love that because what they were saying is this. They were saying no matter what happens, no matter what goes wrong, no matter if we're persecuted, no matter if people come in and torture us in some way, they said with sincere hearts, they continued to meet together every day. They could physically be hurt for what they were meeting together to do. And they believed in their plan so much, they believed in Jesus so much, that they said, we're committed to this. And I will have to tell you that I bet there were times when persecution came in and they were like, man, I don't know if we should keep doing this. Let's sneak around. But they committed to it. And I have to tell you that you and I need to understand that when we've come up with a plan and when we've agreed on it and when we've bought into it, just because something little goes wrong doesn't mean that we abandon the plan, because we have too many people abandoning things. Just because something has gotten messed up in your life, it's no reason to abandon the gospel. It's no reason to abandon the church. Like, if you believe that God is God and he's going to be first in your life, then you've got to be committed to him. And you have to stay the course. No matter what happens, no matter what losses I experience, if I still believe that God is God and he is on the throne and I will spend eternity with him one day, then I stay the course. They were committed to it each and every day to get together in the temple courts. You realize that? They were doing it out in public. And they were making it well known. And I have to tell you, parents, your children need to know that you're praying. And your children need to know that you're reading the Bible. That was very helpful for me with my family. I saw my mom pray every day, and I saw her list of prayers, and I was on that list. And I probably needed it more than anybody else, but I was on that list, and I saw my mom read her Bible every day, and that impacted me, because I thought, if she is that committed, then God has to be real. Then he has to be real. Because you'd have to be crazy to spend all that time for something that was fake. And so that made a difference in my life. And I think you can make a difference in your kids' lives as well. And so lastly is this. You have to notice the results. So verse 47 said that the early church, they began praising God and enjoying the favor of all people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. You see, I told you that I first of all committed to losing some weight. So when the doctor said, wow, you've lost 35 pounds, I was like, awesome. You know, and when I lose the next 20 pounds, hopefully that'll be better. I'm hoping to go down a couple size shirts and stuff, you know, which will be great. And my belt won't have to feel so much pressure anymore, you know. So, but I hope to get down that. But I'm going to notice some results. And some of you will notice those results as well, because you'll see it. And I think that we as a church have to understand this. When you and I are committed to the Word of God, and when we begin to pray, and we begin to be there for one another, we begin to discuss things. It says that iron sharpens iron. That means as you're reading the Bible and I'm reading the Bible, and we come together and we discuss it, man, we're challenging and developing one another. And we need to start beginning to notice the results. I have to tell you, from the small group thing that we've been doing Sunday nights, I've noticed the results in people. Because I've heard their stories, I've heard their struggles, and I hear the way they're growing. I have to tell you, in my own house, I've been committed to doing devotions with my kids as individuals. And I started quizzing my kids. And it's funny, Isaac, if I forget to quiz him, he comes, Dad, time to quiz me. And he's been getting all the answers pretty much right, because we've been taking that time to do that. And I'm noticing the results. And I would like to tell you that you're going to notice all these great things all the time, but you're not. But when we begin to notice the results, listen, when I start losing weight, what I realize is this. I fit into clothes better. I don't breathe as heavy when I'm walking up and down steps. I can do more activities with my kids. When you put the Word of God at the center of who you are, you're going to start noticing that you and I begin to respond differently. We begin to have more hope, and we persevere through it all. Would you stand with me this morning, church? And let's just pray together. Father, I want to thank you for all of these that have been in our congregation today. And Father, I pray that you would have spoken through your Holy Spirit to individuals who would say, you know what, that's true. We need to come up with a plan that makes sure that God is first. And we need to figure out what makes sense for us, what works for us, how we read best, how we understand best, or there's certain things that we need to listen to, but make it a priority to say, you know what, the Bible is going to be important to us. Church is going to be important to us, and we're going to keep moving forward. And I pray for those that are just struggling with different things at homes, even like me, where you're trying to figure out how do you raise kids in this sort of generation and how do you make sure that they're always on the right track. I pray that you would help us to begin to develop plans alike that would say that, you know, at the end of the day, our kids respect us, they love us, and they're going to figure things out. For those who are struggling in their marriages, help them to develop some kind of plan that would say, this is how we're going to move forward. For those at work who are struggling, Father, may they develop plans as well to say, this is how we're going to move forward. And Father, we can't do any of this apart from you. So I pray that your Holy Spirit would just reach down into our lives. Allow us to take some time where we step back for a moment. We realize here's the different things we need to do. Here's the ways that we need to be challenged. Here's the plan that we're going to have. We're going to be committed to it. We're going to buy in. We're going to stay the course. We're going to celebrate moments. And then we're going to really enjoy the results of it. So thank you, Father, for meeting with us now. We give you praise and glory. In your name we pray. Amen. Hey, church, thanks for being here today. Hopefully we'll see you again next week.
Once again, thanks for listening. If you are in the Marion area, we would love to engage with you at one of our Sunday morning gatherings. For directions, service times, and information about our fantastic children and student ministries, visit us at dayspringwesleyan.org. That's dayspringwesleyan.org.